Thank you. Okay, I've got 90 seconds to speak to this slide, so I'll do my best. I don't want to be overdramatic with that first point, but I do think we're moving into a completely new era where the world of school governance, as we know, it is going to change massively. I'm chair of governors of two maintained primary schools at the moment. There won't be school governors in the sense that we recognise that in the new system. If we move to a fully academised system where all schools are a multi-academy trust, we'll have trustees of charities that are overseeing more than one school, and we'll have local governors, local governors that aren't governors in the sense that we recognise in terms of paying governors, I know we're going to move on to think about this quite a lot this evening. I know that some people have very strong views, strongly held views on this. I've heard people talk about it being immoral. The white paper talks about the role getting bigger, and we've seen that even in the current system. I'm, as I say, chair of two primary schools at the moment. So when I was asked last year to take over chairing a school that was in special measures and an interim executive board, I couldn't have done that if I hadn't been paid. So I've been paid as well as a governor. And personally, I have no issue with that in that context. So I'll be interested to hear other people's views. We're moving into a situation where we're going to have fewer governors, and the figure of 300,000 gets bandied about. I don't think anyone really knows how many governors there are at the moment, but we're moving into a situation where we'll have one board of trustees over a number of schools. We're going to have fewer local governing bodies, so that number of governors involved in the system will reduce. My question for individual governors, I was asked this at a conference a couple of weeks ago. I found it a very challenging question. If you were governing at your best, what would that look like? And we went on to talk about the barriers that stopped us governing at our best. So my question for you tonight to follow that up is, if you were being paid for your time, would that help to facilitate the capacity that you would need to govern at your best? It's just something to think about. And then finally, a question for governing bodies. Do you have a plan that includes cementing partnerships? I don't say moving into a multi-academy trust. That's the environment we're being strongly encouraged into. But it's about those partnerships. Who are we going to partner with? How are we going to get to a point where we can structurally partner with other schools? And I'm sure Emma will talk about the Federation First campaign that the National Governors Association has just launched, which deals with the kind of people issues around partnering with other schools. The legal issues of converting to academy, they're relatively straightforward. The solicitors can deal with those. But it's the people issues of how you get to a situation where you're working together structurally. Have you got a plan for that? Have you got a plan for who those people are going to be? And if not, it's time we start thinking about it. I'm sure I've gone over my 90 seconds. I apologise.
That's fine, Ruth. Thank you very much. I hope that's okay. Right, Nigel, if you'd like to do yours now.
Hello, thank you. That sounds as if most people can hear me now. Thank you. I hope it's worth it. Good evening, everybody. I think there's an important link between the original topic of this discussion about should governors be paid and Tuesday's pre-budget announcement, which took us all, at least partly by surprise. And I think it's something to do with the business-likeness of governance, which has been an issue certainly for 25 years since local management of schools came in. I think there's a difference between business-like governance, which we should all be striving for, and business values in governance, which I'm much more sceptical about, which seems to be maybe directly opposed to stakeholder governance with its high levels of democratic accountability. Here's a quick quiz. I won't wait to hear you shout answers, but I wonder if you know who wrote this in 2009. We're going to replace bureaucratic accountability with democratic accountability. Well, before you agonise too much, that was David Cameron writing in The Guardian of all papers. So we don't seem to have moved. What we're moving towards is the domination of professional accountability over democratic accountability. And they're quite different things. And they may well be actually balanced so that sometimes when democratic accountability is high, then professional accountability may be lower and so on. Now, in 2014, at an NGA conference, the then chair of the Parliamentary Education Select Committee said, and I quoted exactly, "I'm less interested in democratic accountability than I am in quality." And the problem with that is, of course, that it's very fine to say that if you're in charge of determining what quality is. There is no clear national consensus now, I think, on what constitutes quality in schooling. Actually, the divide between what the DfE and Ofsted believe about good schools and what the public, especially parents and teachers, seem to believe, that seems to be wider than it's ever been in my lifetime. I think local democratic accountability and democratic participation is an effective way of re-establishing a consensus which would challenge the creeping domination of business values in education, which are exemplified by, first of all, mass academisation and policies like the payment of volunteer lay governors, in other than exceptional circumstances such as IEBs and I think the one that Ruth raised. I'd like to see a different kind of referendum rather than the EU one. What I'd like to see is a referendum on the unhealthy grip that PISA has on our schools. And if we were to have that referendum, I'd join the OUT campaign personally. I want to see our schools run in business-like ways, but in the cause of the central purpose of equipping children with the means of leading a good life. And I do think that the current structures that we have in maintained schools of governance are the best way of achieving that, with some tweaks. Thank you.
Hi, can everybody hear me? Right. Well, as the white paper, I think on the whole, yeah, I think it makes some sense in terms of it seems more logical given that we're going to a more, it's a less atomized system, and I suppose it makes sense in regards to having more schools work together. But the problem is, I think there's not many mats, or too few mats are not that good enough. And I would have preferred much more emphasis on what makes school networks better rather than just saying every school has to be onboarded into an academy. As regards paid governors, I think the problem, the reason why I'm in favour of it is because I think that schools are too important to be left to the strategic direction to volunteers. I disagree totally with Nigel. I think actually that democratic accountability in terms of the local supervision of schools should not trump proper accountability in terms of is that the right thing for the school, of going in that direction, are these the strategic goals that we should set our schools? And I can't for the life of me see why volunteers are somehow more pure and disinterested than paid for governors, who after all most of parent governors, staff governors, community governors have interests of their own, which often get in the way of the proper effective management of the school. In particular, for instance, I know swathes of schools in London who have been denied good primary schools and secondary schools in London, who have been forced to limit their intake because of opposition from parent governors, which is quite reasonable. Why on earth would you want your school disrupted if your child goes there by expanding forms of entry? But it's not necessarily that good for the community, and it's certainly not good for the country as a whole. I think in terms of going back again to the white paper, things that could be interesting, I think there was a few snippets in there about admissions. They're consulting on a more joined up approach to admissions. I've no idea what that actually involves, but I think it could be interesting. Question for individual governors, is what you're doing in the school's best long-term interest? Is it not about you, but is it about the school? And the question for GBs, do you have the skills to cope with rapid change? I think, I know, looking at my governing body, I'm the chair of a standalone academy, and we are constantly aware of how much is being flung at us in terms of policy changes, in terms of the funding changes coming up, the changes to the curriculum, which I don't think is enough has been talked about, because I think it's going to be an awful jolt for schools next year. And of course, then there's the ongoing recruitment crisis. And I think that actually, again, coming back to the original point of this discussion, I think that actually paid governors would be a better solution than, and a more professional solution than relying solely on volunteers, which when all said and done, are just limited for their inputs by their own goodwill.
Graham, thank you, Gerard. We're just going to move on to Andy now. Andy Kent.
Good evening. Good
Chair evening. Of
Everyone hear me?
Andy?
Well, I'm still quite shocked, really, that the government has decided to force the pace in the way that it has. And I'd say at the outset that I'm not arguing against the benefits that can come from structured collaborations. I recognise the potential benefits of multi-academy trusts, just as I recognise the benefits of federation in the right circumstances. And I understand that the multi-academy trust is a more robust structure, and some are clearly doing some good work. But given that it wasn't in the manifesto, given that, as Emma, that the Secretary of State indicated last July at the NGA conference in Manchester, she wasn't going to force this through, and I understand Nick Gibbs said something similar in September, listening to the Chancellor last week and the Chancellor announcing a major education change really was quite difficult to take in. So I do think, given that we're talking about something like 15,000 schools to move to academy status, by the end of this Parliament, or to have clear plans to do that, and very accelerated progress indicated in those local authorities that are deemed by someone not to have the capacity. I think that does bring most enormous risk into the school system. It is a revolutionary change, and you set that alongside the curriculum, the assessment changes, the funding changes, the initial teacher training changes, the qualified teacher changes. I think that's an awful lot to ask of a system that actually really, really matters to, you know, many, many hundreds of thousands, millions of parents, children, and others. And I'm not sure the extent of that risk has really been dealt with very clearly in terms of some of the initial reaction we've heard in the media. In terms of actual payment for governors, I suppose I just start from the position that it's not going to happen. It is financially unrealistic. And I sort of almost stop there before getting into the debate, well, would it make a difference? I'm not convinced that it would make any difference at all at the present time. Roll forward a decade. And if Sir David Carter, the National Schools Commissioner's vision is realised, we may be in a different place. I do think that, as Ruth Agnew indicated, interim executive boards, that's completely different. I do think that there should be payment there, and often, but not always, there is. And I do think there should be sensible expenses policies in place and applied in governing bodies and multi-academy trusts. And I still think that doesn't happen that often. I think the thing that I find really alarming in terms of the size of the task is how on earth do government think, do the regional schools commissioners think, that they're going to find a way of brokering partnerships in localities that make real sense? I do think that's an absolutely an enormous task, and although I anticipate we'll see an expansion of regional school commissioner capacity, actually bringing schools together is really, really difficult. I've had quite a lot of experience in my working life in the amalgamation of junior and infant schools, and my goodness, is that complicated, and it takes several years very often for that to work through. And because we know that for collaborations to work, they've got to be based on trust, and because there'll be an awful lot of people trying to work these through who will have a lot to lose, whether that's governors, whether it's head teachers. And I think for parents too, they are not yet ready in any way to understand a system where the era of the single school is over. And I know that is what the National Schools Commissioner and his regional schools commissioners are saying. So I think in terms of for individual governors, I think there'll be varying degrees of awareness about what the direction of travel has been and the sheer scale of the changes. I think that will have increased somewhat in the in the last week or so, because it has really made quite a lot of the national press and the media, and particularly the parent to governor issues. And I think then individual governors need to reflect on whether or not they are able to have the time, and whether they want to be involved in all the major work that will be needed for those schools that haven't yet begun to take a step in this direction. And in terms of governing boards generally, and I'm thinking here about the single academy trusts, the empty multi-academy trusts, and I know many have converted over the last 18 months. It's going to be hard for them to do now without any real sense of who they might partner with. I think for governors and governing boards that they need to find a way to engage with other schools, most especially in their locality. And by that I mean moving beyond the head teacher professional networks, so that to start off with, that there is at least a proper forum where these matters can be discussed, and options appraisals can be begun. So I'm really concerned about the ability of the system to move us forward in a reasonable and sensible way without risking outcomes for children, teacher supply issues, school leader issues, and so on. And just to finish again, to emphasize, I'm not arguing against building bottom up and where necessary with external intervention, effective trust, but it is the most enormous task.
Thank you. Thank you, Andy. Emma, over to Emma Knights of the NGA.
Hello. Yes, in fact, what I wanted to say follows on quite nicely from Andy, because NGA also has concerns about how ready we are as a system to become 100% converted within the next 4 to 6 years, and particularly to form groups of schools which obviously now will be multi-academy trusts. As Ruth mentioned, you might want to do it in a pragmatic way through forming a federation match, which by the time they come to realise they need to do this, actually there may not be partnerships that want them anymore. We're already seeing some schools unable to find multi-academy trusts. People are looking at the schools that maybe have difficult financial situations, that are requiring improvement, and thinking, oh, not sure we want them in our group. And that might actually get worse, given that one of the things in the white paper is going to be performance indicators for multi-academy trusts. So lastly, just a quick word on payment. That's actually one of the things we agree with in the white paper. What the government says there is that we have a rich tradition of voluntary trusteeship in this country. And that's why I completely disagree with Gerard, who compared school governing to using the WI. Actually, you need to compare it to charity trusteeship. So again, fast forward 5 years, that's who will be accountable for multi-academy trust. It's the trustees. And I was slightly alarmed, actually, that the white paper didn't use that word enough. There won't be people called governors anymore once we no longer have local authority maintained schools. And what the government says in the white paper is that in time, the larger multi-academy trust may apply to the Charity Commission to ask to pay their boards. And I agree that may well happen. That's what's happened in a number of housing associations as they've become very large organisations. Some of their board members are paid. But again, I'd say that's not something that needs to be rushed into at the moment.
Emma, thank you very much. We're just going to move on to a slightly different layout now. What we're going to do is move to a time of questions. I'm going to bring up one question in detail that Steve Penny has asked in the chat box, and I wonder if anyone would like to speak to this. I'm going to start with Gerard. I'm aware this could quite easily be seen to be Gerard. Answer the following. But maybe if you could read Steve's question there, and maybe just respond to that, and maybe someone else could come in after that. That would be helpful.
Well, I disagree with the suggestion that payment can't buy commitment. I mean, I think that, you know, teachers are committed, but they're expected to be paid. I don't think it's an either. I don't think it's a kind of binary divide here. If you're a volunteer, it's a good thing, and if you're paid, you're somehow your motives are in question. I think you can both be take money and do a perfectly reasonable job. And I accept, actually, some of the points that some of the others have said that, you know, this is not the time to pay governors. I mean, when I responded to the question initially from Ian, when we set up this debate, it was very, very much, what will governance look like in 5 or 10 years? And I certainly don't think, you know, individual schools should be paying their governors. But if we're moving towards a system where you have a large network of schools, then I suspect my model will be NHS trusts, where you do have paid non-exec members of boards, and I think that's a perfectly reasonable model. I don't see, given that we are expecting governments to do more and more and more in terms of keeping an eye on recruitment, keeping an eye on curriculum changes and all the rest of it, I definitely think there's actually scope there for paid governors. That is not to say, by the way, that I don't appreciate that lots of volunteer governors do a good job. Of course they do, and an awful lot of them, like Steve, are very professional. But I do think that actually the way we organise it, I just think it's schools and the school system is too important to be left just to the tender mercies of volunteers. I mean, I think I'm right. Emma would know better than I, but I think I'm right in saying that no, or very few other systems have governance. High-performing school systems have governors in the same way that we do.
Emma, would you like to comment about other school systems and what they do, high-performing school systems? How do they do governance if it's not a form that we recognise?
Gerard's absolutely right. There are only a few countries that do. New Zealand is one of them. Some jurisdictions actually in the United States now have a system that the maps will look more similar to. So they have school boards over a number of schools. But actually, a lot of other countries have much more similar to local authorities. So in fact, we are also very high towards the school autonomy end. And in other countries, they wouldn't understand about giving quite so much freedom to schools. So we're out on a limb on an awful lot of different things about our system. We are unusual. And I think the importance is that in this country, we have charities and we have trusteeship. So you can't write that whole sector off, because in fact what we've done by building an academised system is actually moved schools into the charity sector. So they are, you know, both charities and also companies limited by guarantee, as many charities are. So I think it was at that point we needed to think, is this what we want to do with our school system? And we need to have checks and balances properly within it. And I think that's why a lot of people have been so concerned about the idea that parents won't have reserved places within the governance system. because the structures that we're developing in academies is very sort of pyramidal structure, with a small number of members right at the top holding the trustee board to account. And I think there's a worry amongst a lot of people that this is becoming quite a closed shop, and that actually, do we really want to rely on 3, 4, 5 people to actually be the guardians of our school system, which is phenomenally important, not only because it's educating all our children, but also it's a large amount of public expenditure. And I would say that's the thing we really need to be thinking about. That's the bit of our governance structure that's not robust, the membership. And I've been throwing out an idea recently which might help join up the idea of a commitment to the community, which would be, instead of having 3 or 4 of the great and the good as members, why don't we have all the parents within the trust as members?
Would anyone like to come back on that, Andy or Ruth or Nigel or Gerard? Nigel, you need to unmute your microphone. Let's just do that.
And anything else? Sorry? One of the things that Emma said there at the last moment was very much the model that I put forward in my book, which is that that every school would have a membership, and they would vote for the trustees who would be governors, and they would have the capacity to remove them if they were completely way off. And otherwise, they would be democratically, the trustees would be democratically accountable to the whole parent body and to other members of the community who wanted to be part of the school. I think that's that would be a very significant blow against what we're moving towards, which is this sort of corporatism. One of the issues, particular issues that I worry about with paying governors is that by paying, you may not get anything better, but what you do is you recruit people into the professional world of education. Now, we've got quite a lot of professionals. We've got Ofsted and we've got DfE and we've got all the teachers and so on. The lay role is different. The lay role is an accountability role, and it's a checking role that only, I think, lay people and volunteers can do, because they remain interested, but with a range of their own interests. And when we move towards corporatism, I think we're on quite a dangerous track. I don't want to be overdramatic, but Mussolini's definition of fascism was, when you can't distinguish corporate power from government power, you're on the way to a fascist state. Well, there are areas of this country and the way that it's governed where corporatism is, you know, more powerful than government, and is certainly replacing local government, and I think that's a real danger.
Can I respond to that?
Of course, yes.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sorry, but I just think that making comparisons between whatever the faults of the drive towards a more match-driven system are, that I don't think they bear comparison to Mussolini's Italy. I do think that, and also I don't see why on earth a lay system of governorship, by its very nature, somehow keeps a school on its toes any more than a non-lay one does. Surely it's down to the quality of people involved. I mean, there are plenty of examples of lay governing bodies who do not support and do not challenge their governing bodies effectively, their schools effectively. So I don't think just because they are directly elected by the members of that community makes them any better to keep oversight of those who are not.
So I was just going to say that I think the idea of each individual establishment being accountable to the parent body on any particular issue would lead to a considerable instability in certain situations, and our children's education is too precious for that. I certainly agree that much more could be done by many schools, many multi-academy trusts, to ensure a connectivity with their parents, and carers. They listen to them, they listen to the staff, they listen to their student voice. And I think that's really important, and it's often something, you know, governance that doesn't work very well. But I also think Nigel is rather over-egging it, really, in terms of the corporatist agenda, albeit that I did hear the government's approach described this morning as totalitarian in terms of its forced academisation, you know, with a small t, a little bit in that, I suppose.
Yeah, do you mind if I just come in on the discussion that's going on in the left-hand panel
absolutely.
At the moment, in the discussion panel at the moment around parents? And it's an issue that some various people have touched on during the course of the discussion. And I started as a parent governor 12 years ago, and I've gone on to become a governor in different capacities. But that's where I started, because I really cared about the school, like, because I had that, I suppose, you know, very, you know, personal commitment, and because it was part of my community as well. Parent governors do often care about the school in a way that other governors, you know, perhaps don't, perhaps are not so fully engaged. So my worry is that with the nature of school governance changing and those roles of parent governor changing, but the whole, you know, role of governors changing, it's going to lead us to you know, towards a recruitment crisis. Some perhaps are already experiencing that in some ways, but that we're going to find it more and more difficult to recruit governors, because the reason that many of us became governors was to get engaged with our communities, to improve our communities, you know, to change things for our children and their peers, not just as our children. And that role is not going to be open anymore, and I think it's going to become harder and harder to perhaps recruit governors in that context.
Can I just ask a follow-up to that? In terms of stakeholder governance, what's the future? I haven't seen, and maybe I've missed it, the role of staff governors. Is that... Parent governors are very specifically mentioned. Staff governors aren't really addressed. And obviously LA governors are a thing of the future past because of the changing status of maintained schools. But what's the panel's view on staff governors? Where does that fit into this kind of maelstrom of stakeholders or not?
Ian, I think we should really leave the term stakeholder governance behind. I think we've moved on from that. I think everybody in the governance world maybe everybody is a slight exaggeration, but most of us in the governance world absolutely believe that we ought to be recruiting people with the skills to do the job properly. And what some of us are asking for is a small number of people who come through a different route in order to stop groupthink, that actually you get the most robust governance when you have a group of people who come at things from a different background, with different views, different experiences, and that as a team, they have the right skills. And the trouble is, if we keep using the phrase stakeholder governance, then people think you're anti the skills agenda, which I just don't hear at all anymore. As a sort of factual thing, it is interesting that staff governance didn't pop up in the white paper, because when the Department for Education put out their consultation last summer, they looked at each of the categories of governance, so they haven't said anything about staff governance. There is a rule that you shouldn't have more than 30% of your governing board as employed by the school, and that's really important. In fact, we think that's too high. It does mean that those people are very conflicted when they come to look at issues of governance. And again, we would support the charity model. In charities, it's thought very poor practice to have your executives on your governing board. So, for example, I'm a chief executive. I'm not a trustee of NGA. And let me tell you, it isn't a problem. And school leaders need to learn how to function in that charity environment. So NGA hasn't really campaigned for this in the past. We've made the point time and time again that it's a huge conflict for executives to be trustees. But we will now be making this point even more in the coming year.
Possibly related, there are a number of LA people, local authority governor folk in the room, and obviously we've got a number of local authority governor folk, as was on the panel. In terms of the local authorities not having the school improvement role anymore, and I know in many local authorities governance is kind of wound up in that, and in some it's quite discreet. What's the general feeling among the panel, and possibly from people in the chat box as well, about the medium-term future for local authority governor services, bear in mind that it's quite a move away from the local authority role in education but almost specifically the governance that hasn't been directly been mentioned unless you count it as part of school improvement. Maybe Andy could speak to that.
Well, can I just start off on that. I mean, I think firstly, I think it's important to emphasise that in many, many parts of England, local authority governor services, in whatever structural way they sit, in other words, they might still be in-house, they might be arm's length companies and so on, are the main provider of support and development, including face-to-face training, for school governors in the maintained sector, and have a significant role also in terms of many academies and free schools, including around clerking, actually. So although I'm fully aware that isn't the case absolutely everywhere, it is still quite significant. It was interesting to see Russell Hobie, the NAHT General Secretary, call last week for local authorities to continue to offer school improvement related services to schools. And clearly they won't be able to, and many still do that in a number of places again in the country. And I'm a governor in one of the governorships I have is in an authority very much like this. They are a very significant and quality provider of both governor services and school improvement services. Now clearly things are changing and will change, but I think it'll be a problem for the system as we go through this next period if that isn't managed in a reasonable way, because it's still quite an immature market out there beyond that which many local authorities have provided. And I'll add then in the silence, I'll add as well that many local authority governor services have a very strong relationship with the National Governors Association and other providers, but the NGA and perhaps in particular, in terms of the package of support through service level agreements that school and academies buy.
Yes, and I think that those local authorities who have good services will trade them. Now they may, I mean a lot of local authorities have already started to do this, to move them into arm's length companies or trusts, but I think that will continue, because if you run a good service, you can cover your costs, and we do know in large parts of the country that academies buy into those services as well as local authority maintained services. So they are very patchy in places, and they may become more so, but there are also services who are trading outside their traditional geographic borders, which is perhaps no bad thing to be giving people choice.
Just a question for Nigel here. Nigel, this is from earlier, from Ian Dews. Forgive me if I said that wrong. How democratic is you talk about democracy in terms of governance, how democratic is it at the moment, bearing in mind the low turnout in local government elections, very few schools have local councillors in their governing boards in terms of, you know, what traditionally was referred to as an LA governor, and some governors won't represent groups of the views of groups of people who are actually related to the school.
Well, I did say earlier, Ian, that we don't have and haven't had an ideal system, but you don't deal with democracy by saying, oh well, people aren't turning out, so we'll not bother to have votes anymore. There is increasingly, I think, a democratic deficit in the country in terms of the service, the public services that we call upon. And to sit back and say, oh, well, people don't come anyway. In fact, you know, I go to many, many schools which are making a real success of governance, of lay-involved governance, participatory governance, and get the relationships absolutely right. I mean, it's very interesting that 25 years ago, when the current system was introduced, head teachers and their professional associations, amongst many other professionals, were really wary of parent governors, and they really campaigned very strongly against it. Well, they don't do that anymore. They, head teachers and the professional associations, that's my understanding, are very keen on parent governors, and they're standing up now and saying we don't want to lose them, because they recognise that they are allies in the understanding understanding of education as being more than just about getting good results and rising up the PISA international tables. So we should be constantly looking for different ways to develop democracy, because the school is a wonderful training ground for it. And Michael Duane said years ago, you need to practice democracy, you need to give people arenas in which to practice it, and then they'll get involved and they will come out and engage.
I'm sorry, go on. Now to you, Anthony.
To govern, in a way, need to show that actually volunteer governance doesn't work, and I don't think that's proved. What we see from governing bodies, both by the way in the maintained sector and in academy, is there are some fabulous ones and some atrocious ones, and it's probably a bit of a bell curve with most of us near the middle. So absolutely, there are some governing boards that need to get a lot better. But actually the problem is probably not that they need to be paid. The problem is possibly that they need a better chair. And I think we should talk about how we bring good chairs into governing boards, because actually a new chair can absolutely turn around the culture and effectiveness of a governing body. And I could probably talk about that for the rest of this session. So I'll be quiet now, but I really think it's important that we start talking about what makes us better at governing rather than what makes us as democratic.
Gerard, you wanted to come back?
Sure. I mean, I have no idea why we talk about that so much, democracy so much in the school system, when it seems to be completely absent in the health service, for instance. I don't see why on earth, you know, more democracy, which will be professionally run service, is necessarily a good thing. I just do not get it. I mean, there are many times, as I said at the very beginning, where democracy, a circuit of democracy, has prevented perfectly good schools from expanding because middle-class parents usually did not want to see their school expand, even though it was a very, very good school and could give a lot to the community. So I don't take that at all. And I think, you know, it's something that is peculiar to education in England, and I don't see why the talk of democracy is such a big deal.
Ian, can I just come in to follow up Emma's point about chairs? It's a particular area of interest of mine as well. And the role of the chair as a leader on the governing body is such an important one and sometimes overlooked. And I just wanted to mention, lots of the people listening will be aware of, you know, various support mechanisms for chairs, but I did just want to mention the National Chairs Development Programme, which is available, which I know, looking at the comments, some of you have been involved in, a way for chairs to get together to talk about leadership skills and developing their own leadership skills. And is it okay if I just mention as well, National Leaders of Governance haven't been mentioned as yet, and I work for the National College as a National Leader of Governance advocate, I should declare that. But there are National Leaders of Governance all over the country, some of them not deployed at the moment, with skills and experience to support and mentor chairs of governors that are new to the role or in difficult circumstances or in changing circumstances. And chairs may not be aware that resource is there, but it is, and it would be great to see, you know, take up of that as well to help support them in that incredibly important leadership role.
Ian, I noticed there's a question, I don't know whether you want us to come on to it next, but there's a question up there about what happens when the Board of Trustees is weak and doesn't have the appropriate skills.
That feels like it fits in with a good chairing and a good leadership sort of element.
Absolutely, and about oversight of the system and how quickly we're moving to Academy Trust, because the model is that the government has set out is obviously that the Board of Trustees is held to account by its own members, but if that fails, then it is the Regional Schools Commissioner on behalf of the Secretary of State who will have the job of identifying that the Board of Trustees is weak, working with them, possibly encouraging some change, possibly moving schools away from that multi-academy trust into another. So I think it is incredibly important, because what we do, and I think that's the gist of the question, and Denise is absolutely right, but what we do is we build more risk into the system by putting more and more schools, and I'd say more and more pupils, actually the number of pupils that you're responsible for is actually probably more important than the number of schools, the number of buildings that you're in charge of. As you bring more and more pupils within that one board, their ability to govern becomes even more important. And I worry that the Regional Schools Commissioners at the moment don't have either the capacity or the expertise within their head teacher boards to really understand what makes for strong governance. So I know they're going to get a little bit more resource, but we were really disappointed that the government hasn't taken up a recommendation that we've been banging on about for a couple of years, but certainly more importantly the House of Commons Select Committee said that RSC's offices and the head teacher boards needed more governance expertise. Because that's actually what RSCs are doing. They're holding the, or they should be doing, they're holding the boards of trustees to account. Whereas I think often, because they are, most of them are head teachers and the head teacher board members still are, they think about the professionals rather than necessarily the board. So I think there needs to be a lot more work done to make sure the oversight of those boards of trustees is good, especially as they become more and more important as they take on oversight for more and more people's education.
Mm. And just a question there from Vanessa, it's asking about MATS, just kind of fact-finding, I guess. How do MATS currently deal with their boards of trustees in terms of payment and remuneration?
Currently, although ever so often there are rumours going around that MATS have started to pay their chairs, actually in practice very, very few do. Mainly they do it akin to, Ruth already mentioned, interim executive boards, which are put into place in challenge local authority maintained schools. We absolutely think that IEB members should be paid. It's not governance, it's something extra on top of governance. And similarly, MATS will bring in, they often call them rapid improvement boards when they've got failing schools, and often they are paid. But other than that, currently, MATS are using volunteer trustees.
Okay. On a related point,
folks, we are going to...
Wait, do you mind if I just make one more point, just on a related point about quality of boards? I just think, and I know the NGA is doing some work around this, and we're expecting more guidance from DfE as well, but I'm not sure yet there's enough clarity as to what being on a board is supposed to be like, what good practice being on a board is supposed to be like, what chairing a board should be like, the kinds of things that should be discussing at board level within a multi-academy trust. So I hope Emma will tell me NGA is working on this soon, and we'll see more guidance about good practice. So what a really good multi-academy trust board looks like, and the skills that are needed to chair that board, direct that board, be on that board, and being properly involved around those strategic decisions.
Mm-hmm. Just a point.
Sorry, Gerard.
Can I? Emma made a point earlier about what is the difference. She could see no evidence that paying poor governors would produce better governors, and I agree. There's no evidence there. There's no evidence to the contrary either, as far as I'm aware, but there's no evidence there. So I guess what I'm coming from is that I think that if you pay for a role, it's pretty straightforward. You're here to do a job. I expect to see this. And the trouble with being a volunteer, sometimes I find, anyway, is that it's very murky. Even though your responsibilities are set out in the contract, actually, you can withdraw your goodwill at any time, and people tend to say, I mean, I've had it said to me before, if I've spent 2-3 days a month in school, oh, but you're only a volunteer. And sometimes I think, yes, I'm only a volunteer. What am I doing here? And I think the great thing about a paid contract, I'm not talking huge amounts here, I mean, a pretty nominal amount, but it is clear, you know, this is what you do, this is what you get, we expect this, all that. And I suspect, and I think that is a plus, especially when we move to a more complex system and when Matt's overseeing more and more schools. The other thing, of course, is that actually, you know, people will have to go for these positions, you have to advertise for them, and I think I suspect at the moment, a lot of the Matt's anyway, is very much kind of thinking that on the golf course, and do you want to come and be on our government body? But, that's my thought.
And Bob West has just commented in the chat box, and I think it's echoing something that Emma, I think, has said for a long time, how difficult it is for a chair of governance to hold down a full-time job. Is that getting to the... Is that almost selecting the sorts of people who can be chairs? Or is the kind of... Does the payment and the kind of remuneration start to address that, Emma, would you say?
I think that's why, as Matt's grow, that may well be a necessary... thing to move on to payment in order to secure people's time. But there's we have a real concern about the amount of time, particularly chairs, are spending on governance. Because if you make the comparison with the charity sector, by and large, chairs of school governing bodies are spending more time than chairs of other charities. And why is this? We have very, very little evidence about this. So actually, NGA is doing a piece of work now on exactly that, trying to find out why it is we're spending so much time governing compared with similar sized organisations within the charity sector. And there are a number, I mean, we'll find out soon, so I shouldn't really be preempting this, but there is a little bit of a concern that actually there are still an awful lot of governors who possibly count things that aren't actually governing, and that what you will do by moving to multi-academy trust is you will have to have a more strategic trustee board. And that actually possibly will make it more akin to other charities of similar sizes. So I'm not necessarily sure it's about being paid or unpaid. It may be because actually we need to fine-tune what it is that we are spending our time on. And one of the things we want to look at is the fact that currently governing bodies spend an awful lot of time dealing with things outside meetings such as complaints, panels of various sorts, whether they be staff panels, recruitment panels, disciplinary panels, exclusions, and actually there might be a better way of dealing with those issues rather than expecting governors to do that over and above the core governance job.
Andy would like to come back with something, I think.
Well, I think just to say that one of the things that we understand to be the vision and the direction of travel is that we are going to be looking at far fewer boards, in the next decade, beyond 2022. And I think in terms of the range of skills that you would want and the type of person that you're going to be looking for, with the 1,000 MAP boards across the country, which Sir David Carter has been talking about, it'll be unrecognizable from sharing an individual governing body, governing board, whether it's an academy currently or a maintained school.
Does reducing away from that 300,000 figure, which is quoted everywhere as if it's kind of a mythical kind of the 300 from sort of Sparta or something like that, isn't it? It's the 300, the 300,000. It's that.
It's an overstatement. It's an overstatement, yes, Ian. I think now.
Does coming down from that significantly make things like payment and remuneration more feasible? Is that one of the kind of consequences of the rationalising of all this, that it makes payment not viable, but less unaffordable than it currently is?
Absolutely, and I think that's what the white paper is saying, that as MATs grow, that is a different scenario. I'll tell you where the 300,000 is, because we created it a couple of years ago. Before that it was always 350,000 that was quoted, and then after reconstitution, most people will know local authority maintained schools had to reconstitute over the last couple of years. We took the average size of a governing body and multiplied it by the number of schools there are in the country, so that's how we got to 300,000. But you're absolutely right, in 5 years' time we will have trustees, and we really need to start adopting this language. We will have trustees, as Andy says, en masse, a smaller number. Those are the people that might end up getting paid if they're in a larger MAP. I think we're still going to see a lot of MAPs that are, say, 5-6 schools. That might not be necessary, particularly if they're primary schools. They might not be any bigger than one single secondary school. But the people who are governing at school level will be called something different: academy council members, committee members. And I think that will continue to be a lay governance job. I think that, as Ruth was talking earlier about how important parents find that role, how they want to get involved, that could be a really good job, rewarding job, for parents and others to get involved with. We're just finished, actually, a consultation of our members over the last 2 months, asking them about what should be the role of that governing body at local school level. And we've had some great conversations that we'll be writing up shortly. You probably don't have lots of time for me to go into it now, but the key thing that came out of it was people knowing there was a need for the sort of eyes and ears at school level. So that role of engaging with parents, with pupils, with staff, with the community, listening, reporting back, and then feeding up to the board of trustees. That I think that is an incredibly important role, and it's one that we don't always do terribly well at the moment.
A couple of extra questions there from Simon and Jim. Just maybe to tail off with.
Well, to Simon's point, as long as they don't spend too much time on the golf course, yes. And to Jim's point, well, I guess, you know, if we're talking 10,000 governors rather than 300,000, I think it'd be a lot easier. 300,000.
And actually, can I just say, most of the research that we've got on governing groups of schools actually comes from federations, because let's face it, MAPs haven't actually been around for very long and haven't been researched very much. But actually, a federation is a similar idea, with one governing board responsible for a number of schools. And that's what we do find, by and large, that federation governing bodies are more strategic than standalone governing bodies. And secondly, with Jim's question, yes, we'll need fewer trustees. Let's not call the people who are governing at school level governors, because it's creating so much confusion. People that are used to governing in a local authority maintained school think then they'll do the same job in a multi-academy trust, and they absolutely won't. So those committee members, we might still need almost as much of from them, but we won't be asking them to take the responsibility they currently have. So if you think of all the tricky things that governors and trustees across the country are having to deal with now, you know, reviewing staffing structures, making people redundant, potentially really looking at financial effectiveness, looking at staff-pupil ratios, there's a whole range of really complicated issues that we're dealing with. Those folk who are governing at academy council level won't be having...
Can I just come in on Simon's question? Because I think there's a danger that we almost think it's going to happen by magic, that when people are put into a board situation, they'll have to be more strategic. My worry is, we're supposed to be strategic at the moment. We're not always very good at that. And I do think we need much greater clarity of what good practice at that level looks like. And also, we're going to need effective training for people that are going into that role to make sure they understand what being strategic looks like and feels like and what it means.
To that point, Emma, can I ask Emma, why in your research, why were governors and confederations more strategic?
can't do that if you're governing five schools. So it really meant that people reviewed their sort of roles and fine-tuned the information that they got up from each of the schools.
So they were distant but objective.
Sorry?
They were distant but objective.
Distant. I don't think Federation governors would like to be thought of as distant, but yes, they didn't spend as much time in each of the individual schools. Some of them do still have links, but actually there's a real pro and con about that, so I wouldn't necessarily recommend that. But also it really depends on size. A lot of federations are really very small because they are, say, five or six primaries coming together. So I think, you know, once you start getting thousands and thousands of pupils, we need to think, you know, very differently about what information needs to come up, and possibly have cluster boards. Quite a number of multi-academy trusts are grouping schools in clusters and having boards that, again, responsible for about five or six schools, because that's doable. Ian, can I just respond to Jim's question? He's put a comment up after the last conversation saying, in that case, I will not be continuing after 25 years as a governor. And I'm not quite sure whether he meant he didn't want to be a trustee or he didn't want to be a local academy councillor. But I think different people will want different things. Some people will want the responsibility of being a trustee and to take that on, knowing full well how important a role it is. Whereas actually other people don't want that, and they were the people I would say might actually suit a new role, which is much more about being the life, part of the life of the school. One of the pieces we've just published in our most recent magazine was looking at what are the bits people love about governance and what are the bits they could do without. And it won't surprise you to know the bits they love are the contact with the school, the being part of the community, putting something back into the community, knowing that they're making a difference to pupils. So actually that's what makes people govern, not sort of, you know, sitting in a room considering large amounts of financial or performance data. So no, not everybody will want to continue governing. We might need to appeal to slightly different people at the different levels.
Ian, could I briefly address the 14,000 or so schools that are not yet academies and have been told they have to be? I was with one of these just last Tuesday evening, and they were saying, what do we do now? I think this is precisely the time when these schools need, the governing boards need to be absolutely strategic. They need to sit down now and say, what is our vision for what we want the children to get out of our school? What is our view of the ethos of the school? What do we want it to be like? What sort of experiences do we want it to give the children? And then what is our strategic direction? What are the key issues going to be over the next 4 or 5 years, which apart from academisation, as well, stolen the picture here. But there are other big issues around in schools. There are poverty, increasing child poverty, 1 in 3 children likely to be living in actual poverty by 2020 in this country. Children's mental health, staff recruitment and retention, and staff mental health and leadership. So they've got to find those issues and make sure that they're working or going to be working with schools that share those problems and share those views, and particularly share the vision and the ethos.
Okay, folks, we're going to, we have run over, did give this extra quarter of an hour, just in case we did run over, and we're about to go over that extra quarter of an hour as well. So apologies for that. Apologies for the audio problems at the start. Hopefully we've all kind of resolved that. Just wanted to ask a few questions at the end. We asked this question at the start. I'd be interested to get your take on it now, the one that's directly below me, directly below Andy. And Yeah, we'd also like to find out if you'd like to do this sort of thing again, maybe a bit more focused. This has been very general because the white paper is very, very general and very, very non-detailed in some respects. But as it progresses and as the kind of it starts to solidify, would this be something that you'd find useful? We are more than happy to take your suggestions for a particular topic area. I'm already thinking about doing some stuff about helping schools prepare for the inevitable, and how do you kind of be strategic about your when you're approached by a MAT or when you're thinking about forming a MAT, doing those sorts of things. So if you've got suggestions for those, if you're on the mobile app, you won't be able to... fill in the topics and suggestions, last question. So just please put that, put a suggestion in the chat box on over there on the left-hand side. That would be brilliant. Thank you. Thank you very much to the panel. And folks, while people are filling that in, is there anything anyone has got to say? Maybe a 30 seconds at the end, if they'd like to. You don't have to. It's clearly optional.
I think there's a lot of work to do over the next.
Okay, let's start with Andy. Andy, you go.
I think there's an awful lot of continuity, if you like, into, you know, over the next 12 to 24 months. As we work through the implications of whatever comes from the white paper. I do hope that the House of Commons and the House of Lords, the Select Committee, are going to do a really good and serious job. So whatever actual legislation comes out of this and associated guidance is actually rooted in the in a very robust analysis of where we are now, and that the civil servants are actually giving very straight messages, even if behind closed doors sometimes, to relevant ministers.
Gerard, would you like to go next?
Yeah, I mean, for me, we are, I am a chair of a standalone academy, and I think the question for us really, when all said and done, is the same as it was before the white paper, through the due time break, really. And we know that actually, given the headwinds, financial headwinds, what the recruitment headwinds, and everything else that's coming down the pipeline, it really isn't about, you know, to academise or not to academise. Even when we have academised, those questions are still put to the forefront of our mind. Who do we cooperate with? Who do we gain partnerships with? And they're very big questions, and it's very difficult actually for a governing body, I think, who necessarily see the way through the morass that's out there.
And Ruth?
I would agree with Gerard. I think that's going to be the biggest challenge for all of us. Those that aren't in academy arrangements at the moment aren't already in partnerships. I'm worried there's going to be a kind of frantic now, rushing around trying to make groups of friends at schools, you know, to go into multi-academy trust arrangements. You know, we've got to do better than that as governors. We've got to find a way that we can do this properly and thoughtfully, but in a way that's in the best interest of our schools. And that, for me, is the biggest challenge.
And Nigel?
Well, I would just like to repeat my worry about the danger of business values submerging and subverting the initial purpose, the real purpose and the core purpose of education, because we've seen what it's done in other areas of our lives. We've seen how sport, how the press, how the health service, how politics and banking, perhaps above all, have been subverted by business values when people have forgotten what the core purpose of the operation is. And to ask ourselves, how has this worked for the least favoured in our society, for the most vulnerable in our society? How has it worked for ordinary people? And how likely is the system that we're moving towards to promote the values that I think most of us would espouse in education about equality of opportunity and human happiness?
And Emma.
Thank you. I mean, I think it's down to those of us who are governing, whether we're currently in maintained schools or already in academies or multi-academy trusts, to make sure that we always keep that at the front of our minds. That's why we're volunteering. We're volunteering in the interest of the pupils. And absolutely, any organisation needs to keep its purpose at the forefront of whatever it does. And you quite rightly, Nigel, just pointed out, our purpose is the purpose of education. Having said that, we need checks and balances in our system, and I think the white paper is in danger of removing some of those checks and balances. So I think all of us need to make sure that actually there's really good scrutiny, both of the white paper itself and of any legislation that comes after it. And I always say this, really, every time we have something controversial, but I think I probably mean it more now than ever before. We're not terribly good within the school sector of using the democratic routes that we have open to us. Other parts of society, whether that's, you know, the animal rights movement or the, you know, the climate change folk, are much, much better at lobbying their elected representatives. So I'd suggest all of you, whatever your views, do that, because obviously there's an awful lot of debate going on at the moment in Parliament and indeed in the Lords about a whole lot of different issues, and we need to make sure that people understand the issues we're dealing with, because quite frankly, you know, school governance and up until the last couple of days hasn't been something that we've seen the press get interested in. And then just finally, absolutely, the information for governors and trustees is absolutely paramount. We're going to be continuing to publish things over the rest of this academic year and beyond. So I think it's sort of, you know, stay in touch. And the people that are on tonight, I'm sure will do and already know an awful lot. The people we worry about are the folk who don't know anything about any of this yet. We need to make sure they don't get left behind.
Absolutely. Folks, thank you ever so much for attending. It's been, I appreciate that, you know, we always talk about governors using their time, and this is, you know, just another suck on your already beleaguered time, isn't it?